Hello friends, today we will discuss about the difference between the type 1st superconductor and type 2nd superconductor. Very simple difference is there. Now first difference, it has one critical field HC. I mean type 1st superconductor, only one critical field were used. Whereas in type 2nd superconductor, two critical field were used, that is HC1 and HC2. Second difference is, transition from superconducting state to a normal state in the presence of the magnetic field occur sharply at the critical value HC. Means type 1st superconductor occurs when the material changes its state from superconducting state to normal state at critical value or critical value HC. Okay. Whereas in type 2nd superconductor, if external magnetic field is less than HC1, material remains superconductor. Listen carefully. When or if the external magnetic field is less than HC1, material remains superconductor. And when H increases above HC2, their superconductivity is destroyed. This is the second difference. Okay. Now third difference. Below HC, they are a diamagnetic, means below critical or below critical value or below critical field, the type 1st superconductors are perfectly diamagnetic. Whereas in type 2nd superconductor, for HC1 is less than H, H again less than HC2, they exist in magnetically mixed and electronically superconducting state. Now next difference, they are poor carrier of electrical current. Type 1 superconductors are poor carrier of electrical current, whereas type 2nd superconductors are good carrier of electrical current. Okay. Now next difference is, the value of HC is 0.01 to 0.2 Weber per meter square. Now in type 2nd superconductor, about 20 to 50 Weber per meter square values of HC2 is there. Okay. And last difference is, example of the type 1st superconductor are aluminium, lead, indium. And whereas examples of type 2nd superconductors are neodymium, silicon, vanadium. Okay. So this is the difference between the type 1st superconductor and type 2nd superconductor. Now next point we'll discuss application of the superconductivity. Now first application of superconductors are, electricity is transmitted and distributed through the cables. So electrical power transmission can be done at a lower voltage level. So for power transmission, these superconducting materials were used. Okay, this is the first application. Now second application, superconductor windings are used in electrical machines, generators and motors. With superconducting materials used in electrical equipment like electrical machine, generator, motors, etc., etc. It is possible to obtain high efficiency and small weight by using the superconductors. If we use this superconducting material in electrical equipment having high efficiency, or for getting the high efficiency, the superconducting materials were used in electrical equipment. Okay, this is the second application. Now third application is, the transformers of 2000 to 3000 megawatt can be manufactured and they will be of the portable type. Okay. Now next application, fuses and circuit breakers can be prepared by using thin film superconductors. Next application, superconducting coils produce magnetic repulsion, therefore speeds up to 500 km per hour can be easily achieved. Understood? Superconducting coils produce magnetic repulsion, superconducting coil produce magnetic repulsion. Therefore, speed up to 500 km per hour can be easily achieved. Okay, this is one more important application of superconductor. Now, next application, it is used in electronic appliances and computers. Now, very important application is squids. Squids acts as a sensitive magnetometer. The heart and brain generates extremely small electric current which set up weak magnetic field of the order of 10 raised to minus 14 to 10 raised to minus 15 Tesla. Squids can measure these feeble fields. Very minute signals are detected by sensor. So these are some application of the so next point we'll discuss band theory of solid. Now what happen in solid? In solid, energy gap between two states depends on the equilibrium spacing between the atom. So that band gap or energy gap between the two state is depends on the spacing between the atoms. Okay, this band gap decreases with decreasing spacing, means as spacing means distance between the atom decreases, band gap between the two state also decreases. Okay, so on the basis of band theory, solids are classified into insulator, conductor and semiconductor. Now generally I will tell you what happen in case of insulator. We see this diagram, then it is observed that now these are the energy levels for the energy diagram for the insulator, semiconductor and conductor. Okay, now VB means valence band, CB means conduction band. Okay, valence band means what? If the band contains valence electron, then it is nothing but the valence band. Okay, conduction band means what? This is the next permitted band which is exactly above the valence band, and that is nothing but the conduction band. Okay, now what happen in case of insulator? If we see this diagram, then it is observed that the band gap or EG indicates the forbidden energy gap. Okay, so forbidden energy gap means gap, energy gap between these two bands is nothing but the forbidden energy gap, EG. Okay, now in insulator that band gap is very large. Okay, now this is the band gap for the diamond and glass, and which is around 6 to 7 electron volt. Now in case of conductor, what happen in conductor? There is a no gap between the two bands, that is there is a overlapping between the bands. Understood? So here EG is equal to 0. Okay, and last one is the semiconductor. Semiconductor means the material having conductivity is lies between the insulator and conductor, then it is nothing but the semiconductors. Now if we see this figure, then it is observed that there is a forbidden gap between the two bands, but it is small compared to the insulator. Okay, so for semiconducting materials like germanium, silicon, the forbidden energy gap is 0.1 to 3.5 electron volt. Okay, so this is about the band theory of solid, that is insulators, semiconductors and conductor. Now next point we'll discuss about Hall effect. Now if often becomes necessary to determine whether a material is an N-type or P-type semiconductor. That means particularly this Hall effect is used to determine whether the material is an N-type or P-type semiconductor. Okay. Now after that, if a piece of conductor, that is metal or semiconductor, carrying a current is placed in a transverse magnetic field. If a piece of conductor, whether it is metal or semiconductor, doesn't matter. That piece of conductor, when we put or placed in a transverse magnetic field, okay, then it produces the electric field is produced inside the conductor in a direction normal to both the conductors, normal to both the current and the magnetic field. So this phenomenon is known as a Hall effect, and the voltage so generated is called as a Hall voltage. So this is about the thank you.